Hello, and welcome back to Workbench Wednesdays. One of the most powerful yet underused features of a digital oscilloscope is their trigger circuit. All the time I hear people say, I should learn how to use that better. Well, my goal here is to explain when to use sweep modes, different trigger types, and how to fine-tune a messy trigger. With that, let's get triggered. For this video, I'm focused on the analog trigger types. We did an episode on protocol triggers for buses like serial UART or I2C. Check the show notes on the Element 14 community for that one. Okay, so looking at an oscilloscope screen, generally the center point is where a trigger event occurs. The most common event or trigger is a rising or falling edge at a specific voltage level. The trigger circuit is separate from the acquisition system. So while the analog to digital converter runs, it fills a circular memory buffer. When the trigger detects an event, it tags the buffer marking time equals zero. This buffer and asynchronous monitoring of the signal is why we can get waveform information before the trigger event occurs. By the way, some scopes have something called a digital trigger. The trigger system in these oscilloscopes monitor the sampled data to detect events digitally. But either analog or digital works about the same for the purposes of this video in terms of using the triggers. Now, coming back to our signal, if I move the trigger level above the signal, the screen keeps updating and now looks really crazy. So why are we getting updates if the signal didn't cross the trigger threshold? The reason is the sweep mode. Digital scopes have auto, normal, and single. Single is the most obvious of the three. The oscilloscope will capture a single acquisition each time you run the scope or press the single button. Now, every scope I know of defaults to auto. To see the other two modes, first we need to set the trigger level to 0 volts. When switching from auto to normal, well, nothing changes. Womp womp. But as I start to disconnect and reconnect the BNC cable, the scope only displays new data sometimes. To understand when, let's first reconnect the cable. Watch as I move the trigger point up. Ah, see, updates only occur when the trigger is valid. Versus auto, which automatically updates the display even if no trigger occurs after a certain amount of time. Typically, auto is best for debug or when you're not really sure what you're looking for. Normal can help when you want to focus on a specific event. It is handy when hand probing. It's also very helpful for slow signals. In auto, we never see the edge of this 1 Hz signal, but with normal, we only get information when the signal transitions. Speaking of transitions, some scopes let you choose rising, falling, or both edges. But both is not really an OR condition. It is rising followed by falling. Let me demonstrate. I connected the oscilloscope's aux out to a very modern counter. Each time the scope triggers, it generates a pulse, and the counter shows the period between them. Since the arbitrary waveform generator outputs a 1 Hz clock, we see a rising or falling edge once per second. But when we set for both, the update now takes about 1.5 seconds and not the expected 500 milliseconds. Interesting, huh? Now, to accomplish that demo, I did have to change one other setting, but I'm going to come back to that later. For now, just understand that the scope looks for one edge and then the other. It's not strictly an OR condition. Okay, now let's move on and talk about my second favorite trigger type, pulse width. In addition to edge, most oscilloscopes usually have a pulse width trigger that supports greater than and less than violations. For this example, I'm using my Mega 2E project, and we're going to look at its 1 MHz clock. While using edge trigger, notice this faint cycle that appears occasionally. Sometimes a pulse is slightly longer than the others. Let's use a pulse width trigger to capture that cycle. First, I use the cursors to see the nominal width time, and then look for something slightly longer or between those two pulses. So here I'm picking 500 nanoseconds. Next, I change the trigger type to pulse width, set for a positive pulse, and I want it to trigger when it is longer than 500 nanoseconds. And now the scope screen only updates when that trigger condition is met. Now, if you don't have a 40-year-old Apple ASIC to try out the same thing, you can use an Arduino instead. A really good way to play with this trigger is to use analog write in a loop like this one. It creates an expanding pulse width that you can use to test out different timeouts. The waveform pauses here because of the timeout we set. The scope only updates when the width is less than 1 millisecond. Pulse width is also sometimes called glitch, but that's basically because it's a shortcut for the fastest width that a trigger can detect. And in general, the more expensive your scope, the smaller the pulse width it can catch. Now, once you understand edge and pulse, you're ready for the majority of trigger tasks. I could go into depth on other modes like runt or window, but well, I don't really have great demos of them. So in short, runt watches for when a voltage of a pulse crosses one threshold but not another. This could be due to droop or an output stage with a slow slew rate. Window is similar, it uses two voltage points but adds a time component. Think of this one as two pulse width triggers combined. Okay, remember when I showed that 1.5 second update thing? You know, it looked like this. Well, let's go back to the trick I pulled for that. Same slow signal as before, but this time I preset the scope before we start. Now, once I get the waveform where I want it, I set the sweep to normal and to trigger on both edges. With that, we can see that the alternating triggers are 500 milliseconds apart this time. You see, before I hid the setting for hold off. Here's a timeline of how a scope acquisition works. The trigger arms itself and starts looking for the event. If auto mode is enabled, it times out after some amount of time. Once the trigger happens, the acquisition buffer continues filling. Then the data is transferred to a computer for processing and measurements and all the other fun scope stuff. Once all of that is done, the trigger circuit rearms itself. Now, the time from when the trigger happens until the scope can rearm, it isn't watching the signal anymore. We call that the acquisition dead time. Hold off is an additional time we can add before the trigger circuit rearms itself. The either trigger was armed for a rising edge. The scope captured and displayed it. And then I added 600 milliseconds of hold off, causing the trigger to wait to rearm itself. Now the trigger is armed and looking for a falling edge. But since we missed the next edge, we have to wait until another cycle of our signal, or about 1 second. This behavior demonstrates that the either trigger cannot detect the same edge back to back. It has to see one and then the other. FYI, the dead time I mentioned is related to the acquisition rate of the oscilloscope, or how fast can it update the screen. The period between triggers increases as you change time base, use more memory, add measurements, and many other things. Also, depending on the class of scope, there may be modes that reduce the dead time by disabling certain features. Okay, next, let's talk about what to do when trigger circuits are a little too good. Here, I'm using a falling edge trigger, yet we're getting both positive and negative cycles even with normal sweep mode. With single shots, we can see the sine wave is relatively low frequency with high frequency noise on it. It turns out the noise is fast enough that the trigger detects its changes as the falling edge. Kind of annoying, right? To get around this minor problem, most oscilloscopes have a noise reject filter. With that enabled, now we get a reliable trigger on the signal's edge and not the noise. Some scopes also have adjustable hysteresis, which qualifies the signal's edge. It's like adding a Schmidt trigger to the trigger. By the way, when I did a hands-on review of the Analog Discovery Pro, I specifically mentioned its adjustable hysteresis and how I liked the way it looked on screen. In general, you won't need to really mess with the noise filters or hysteresis all that often. But if you're looking at a noisy signal, you might have to play around with a combination of those settings to get a stable trigger. There are a bunch of other little features available with most triggers, but I think the key thing to learn first is the sweep modes. Using normal can help you see only the things that matter, then play around with the capabilities of your pulse width trigger. And finally, know about hold off and hysteresis, as well as noise reject filters for when you're dealing with noisy signals. Visit the Element 14 community to find show notes with links to the tools used in this video. Remember, if you have triggering questions, that is the best place to ask me because I'm more likely to see and be able to answer them over there. Also, if you can, please post a link to your oscilloscope's datasheet or manual when asking about it. As always, thank you for watching. For now, it is time for me to get back to continuously monitoring for unique analog events on my electronics workbench.